can translate massive letters combination punching.
So we want a strong, fast and explosive athlete. But make sure that it's done in a controlled, dynamic way.
Hello everyone and welcome to a very special episode of Boxing Science TV as we're going to review the best bits of 2017. We're coming from a room at Sheffield Hallam University with a big sign behind, a bit different to doing it in my flat. I'm with my colleague and esteemed partner in science, now Dr. Alan Ruddock, as Tyson Fury introduced to the world for you.
Hey Dr. Ruddock. This is Tyson Fury. Congratulations on becoming a knobhead. Good luck in your future, and hope you make plenty of money and become rich like me.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
For that.
So this episode is basically going to go through the highlights of 2017, the different reflections that myself and Alan have had over that time, and the different projects that we worked on as well. So. Start of 2017, January, the boxers coming in, and you know Jordan and Barry got off to a flyer with their training.
Absolutely, yeah. One of the key things that Jordan and Barry do over this Christmas period, which we're about to start now, is that they're on their training out there, training consistently throughout that period of Christmas. You know, and they're looking after the bodies, looking after themselves. You know, they're not one of these guys that go out and binge and you know get stuck into all Christmas food and Christmas dinner, are they? You know, they're in the gym, they're training hard. Mm. And you know, one of the things that we like to encourage is that as well. So I think it's a good time now to talk about, you know, what we've got coming up in January 2018, which is just a few weeks away, and that's Kickstart Your Conditioning Programme.
Yeah, definitely. So Kickstart 2018 programme is going to be available, and it's in the link below. And it's basically training around you coming, returning to training. You might have been on Christmas binge, you might have been sitting about watching Netflix box sets, and you might end up being tight, a little bit overweight as well. And the different issues that boxers, athletes, and just people in general public can have is like they go into like kind of binge training mode where they'll just go really hard at the training and not take the other considerations into mind, like making sure they're having the right calories, making sure that they're doing the right movement training, make sure they're getting the right recovery as well. And what will happen is that they'll get ill and injured. And this guide will help you kind of avoid illness, avoid injury, make sure that you keep going towards your goals. So what are the other issues around training in January?
I think like one of the key issues, like you said there, is that people binge, you know, and not just on food and drink, but also they binge on training as well if they think they've overindulged a little bit. And so when you do that, particularly in the winter period, which we're in the UK at the moment, is that there's a high risk of illness associated with that. Yeah. So you've got to be on it in terms of nutrition, eating the right things at the right time. And we've got our nutrition, part of our nutrition cookbook, haven't we, in the Kickstart Conditioning, Kickstart program.
You'll get it right eventually.
We'll get it. In the Kickstart, let's call it Kickstart.
Yeah.
Kickstart program. Yeah. So that's in there. But we've also got guidelines on how to stay fit and healthy, and how to look after your immune system as well. You know, and what supplements might be useful there, and just some general basic guidelines on that. And then on conditioning as well, and how we can use different types of conditioning methods that will just help you build a base. Not put too much intensity through your body, but be progressing and working through those physiological systems that that underpin boxing performance. So we've focused a little bit more on longer intervals, haven't we? And you know, rather than having the short, intense work that we'd like to put into the program, I mean, you can't do that all year round. So we're putting some longer intervals that's going to develop your central cardiac system and just work on that base level fitness.
Yeah, so that program's now available now. It's in the link below, but here's a quick video to show you a little bit more about the program. Okay, so all that hard training that Jordan and Barry did, and we went into February on the big Chris Eubank Jr. show in London, ITV box office. And it was a bit of a disappointment for us, really, because the complication with the opponents, and basically Jordan's opponent went to be Barry's opponent because Barry's opponent got food poisoning.
Yeah.
And then that left Jordan without an opponent. Someone came in last minute, and in fact, like the curfew ran out because they were expecting knockouts, and the curfew ran out, and Jordan weren't able to box. Disappointing after all that kind of training.
It's always disappointing, isn't it? Even you know, when your opponent pulls out, or you know, they get an injury, or they're ill, or whatever. But to go from having an opponent to not having an opponent, then to having an opponent, and then running out of time, it's just absolutely devastating. But he handled it so well. Obviously, there was that initial disappointment, but from there, from February onwards, he was absolutely flying. On the plus side, you know, although Barry didn't get the opponent that he wanted, he did a job on him, dismantled him completely, and put in a good performance.
Yeah. And that's like the main thing that we say about sports psychology, really, is in controlling the controllables. You know, having Jordan and Barry, they're just like kind of focused on what they can control, because they know that boxing is just such a random sport and different things can happen. Always expect the unexpected.
Yeah.
And, you know, they, end of the day, Barry had to perform against somebody else, somebody totally different to who they prepared for. Jordan had to pick himself back up again and make sure that he's ready for the next date, because and this discussion that I had with Jordan just yesterday is like, if you have a couple of weeks off, that can set you back 2 months. It's like a bit of a domino effect. If you're not 1 week off your training, that can add a little bit longer, and then a fight date might not happen. You've just got to be always ready.
Absolutely. I mean, for our younger boxers, particularly like Jordan, you can't work camp to camp because there's so much more physical development that he needs to do.
Yeah.
He needs to be thinking more along the lines of an Olympic cycle, a 4-year development plan at the very least.
Yeah.
So having that, you'd never see an athlete on Olympic cycle have 2 weeks off, would you?
No.
You know, they're always progression towards different goals and ticking those boxes and making small continuous improvements. So like you say, having that period of detraining can actually have a big domino effect, which is why boxers have got to be careful over the Christmas period, because that can do quite a bit of damage.
Yeah, for sure. So it was really disappointing in London, but actually on my way back up to Sheffield, I stopped off in Stoke, where the university championships were happening. Sheffield City ABC and Brendan Warburton, he leads the both uni teams, which makes a very interesting varsity where you get gym mates like boxing each other. But the books, you know, it keeps getting better and better each year. You know, we're winning medals, gold, silver, bronze medals. Like every year we're getting books points on the board. Two standout performances for boxing science were Rizard and Matt. Rizard defending his open class 75 kilo title, and Matt winning the under 10s. This year he's going to go for the under 20s, but it's really positive that, you know, the club that we're most involved with is supporting the university like this.
Mm, yeah.
So we're going to have a quick chat to Matt a little bit later on in the year, and talking about how Sheffield City ABC has helped him. What's been the success for
Sheffield Hallam Boxing Club over the past 2, 3, 4 years that you've been running it?
Yeah, our last season was the most successful season for both universities. I think in total there were 3 gold medals, 3 silver medals, a bronze medal in British University Championships. And like I said, we've been working with both unions, or with Hallam, for 6 years now. So we're getting students in here, some that have boxed, some that have had other experiences, that have never competed. Matt, who's done a bit of mixed martial arts, come down here and transferred over to boxing. He's had a fantastic season last season. And again, you know, having a gym full of these good kids, when we're getting students in, you know, they've only got to look what's in front, as long as they put them off, you know. But you know, these lads will work with him and bring each other through. Matt showed last season, he had a busy season. And he come back with Yorkshire novice belt. He's going on to having nearly 20 bouts now, Matt. Yeah. So we're moving on to the open class section and championships.
So. Yeah. So what's it like training down here at Sheffield City ABC?
Oh, it's excellent. Set up's class. We do a lot of technique, which is something I love doing. I love practicing, so.
Yeah. So you've been here for, is it your second year now?
Second year, third year is a placement year, which I've got in Sheffield, which gives us next year boxing, which is the main goal.
Yeah, so 2 years of training down here at Sheffield City. Come from a cage fighting background, mixed martial arts. Mixed martial arts background. How's that transition been? You know, you obviously... we're hugely committed to MMA and quite successful in MMA as well. What's been that choice to actually, right now, I'm going to be an amateur boxer?
Well, I first came to Sheffield and there wasn't any MMA gyms. So I thought the worst part about my MMA game was my stand-up. So I'll come to a boxing gym and I've just fell in love with it.
Yeah, and it's great, like, kind of the people in the gym as well. You've been got a bit of footage of you sparring with Callum and Will. How kind of valuable is that kind of sparring for you?
Oh, it's excellent. It's not just the sparring either, it's them as role models. Yeah. You see them, how hard they work, and you know if you want to get to their level, you've got to work as hard as them.
Definitely, and you've got a good coach in Brendan as well. How impactful has he been on your boxing development?
Oh, he's been excellent. He works with you one-to-one, puts a lot of time into you. I mean, he's never out the gym.
Yeah.
He's dedicated as we are, and that's what you need him for.
Right, so we're rolling into March, and a very historic moment was made when we switched up the heat in the chamber, and the curve record was broken probably about 3 or 4 times.
If you've followed us for a while now, you know how excited we get about really silly, simple things.
Yeah.
So. One of those things is just the top speed record on the curve. We've got a curve leaderboard, haven't we? Yeah. You know, everyone's top speed's documented on there. It's a really competitive kind of goal. We try and make it into a bit of an event, but it obviously does have a physiological benefit and rationale behind everything we do. So it's not just we're doing something just to for the champs. It's not like we're doing who can do 100 press-ups as fast as they can.
But
there is method behind. Yeah. Behind the seemingly mad.
Yeah, because everybody, like, for evidence of that is that everybody does PBs at the same time. For example, 29.7 set by Kell Brook in 2014 has been like kind of the number one spot for 3 years, and the lads have all kind of like stepped up at different. More or less at the same time, and then once somebody broke that record, Will broke that record, actually James went on and beat him, and then it was set again, you know, people were hitting 29, high 29s and 30s for fun.
Why did we do it? Why were we having fun and games in March? Because you know, there was a big important competition on the horizon, weren't there? And it, we were coming into like a max speed phase, speed phase, working on that force development and rate of force development. So we were looking for all the guys on the program who were preparing for the ABAs and preparing for the end of the season, I suppose, isn't it? Mm. So, you know, we were getting them into their peak competition period. So what we did was we cranked up the heat in the environmental chamber. And what that does, it just allows the muscles to function at a higher temperature, which it improves the way that the muscles function, and so you're able to hit faster speeds. If you think about it in terms like of a track and field sprinting context, the faster athletes usually perform better in hotter environments, and there's quite a bit of research that has shown that as well. You know, temperatures above 25 degrees Celsius, sprinters do perform 3-5% better in those environments compared to cooler conditions as well. So there's a bit of science behind it, obviously.
There's going to be a lot of people wanting you to explain more on that, but we'd be here until Christmas. Christmas is 3 days away, 4 days away.
So. Wait, Christmas 2018.
So we're going to put out an article about that, follow up, but if you've got any questions for me and Alan about that period, just give us a shout. That was preparing for the ABAs, but first of all, it was Callum Beardo, English title bout, 86 kilos. It was like his biggest bout that he's had since he come back from his injuries, and it was so pleasing to see him, you know, not only win it, but win it convincingly as well, at a new weight class as well. So that was definitely one of the highlights of the year.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, Callum's had a few setbacks.
Yeah.
And so have yourself working with Callum as a coach as well. And it's great when things are going well.
Yeah.
But when things aren't going so well, that's when you learn most about yourself. That's when you're challenged, you know, and you have to think of new and innovative ways of working and pushing yourself as a coach and an athlete, just a little bit like what Jordan's had his setbacks this year as well. And it's all fine and dandy when everything's going well and, you know, you're sailing along nicely, but you might not necessarily be getting that rounded learning experience which you need to have all the way throughout your career, irrespective if you're a 60-year-old pro and you've been doing it for 40 years, you still need to learn from every experience that you get.
For sure. So that was in preparation for the ABAs as well. And, you know, we had quarterfinalists with Rizal Lewicke, a pre-quarterfinalist with Will, and then Cal got to the semi-finals in a close split decision. And it's, even though it's semi-final, wanting to get to the final and win, I'm quite proud of, you know, that was his first ever stint at the senior ABAs. He's only had, I don't know what he's had now, he's probably had 26 bouts by that time. I think it's just under 30 bouts at the moment, and he's coming up against guys that have had 100 bouts and everything like that. So, and we know everything about experience and how important that is. So ABAs, great tournament to be involved with, and not only that, to see the other talent as well. We was preparing for the Combat Conditioning Conference 2017, and it was our first ever online conference. We dubbed it as the first ever in the world in combat sports, which we still believe now, if there's any other proof.
I still think it's the first type of sports science conference that was online and hosted in the particular way in which we did it.
Yeah, for sure. So we, you know, it was a great experience for us to not only kind of present our work to the boxing science audience, but also to be learning from the different people, different practitioners within our field as well. So we had Mark Campbell from Team GB Boxing. We got John Connor from Irish Institute of Strength, who worked with a lot of mixed martial artists and working close to John Kavanagh and his gym in Dublin. Also Israel Halperin in Australia Institute of Sport. And, you know, we're talking like people around the world working with international athletes. What are your reflections from going through that process?
My, first of all, my highlight was probably Johnny Nelson.
Oh, yeah. I don't know why I forgot that.
Johnny, like, and, you know, just think, getting an insight into the way that he trained. And I just remember that little comment that he made about the pitter-patter, pitter-patter. And, you know, he used to go in the gym in the morning when no one else was there. And you have no music on. You see guys all the time training with music on. I don't. Yeah. And so when I listened to Johnny, and he was saying no music on, quiet, and all I was listening for was when he was doing the lines was the pitter patter, pitter patter of his feet, and that resonated with me. Mm. And you know that was a highlight for me. But in terms of the whole experience, just you know, I found it very reassuring that we could reach out to people, you know, maybe at the other side of the world, who were experts in the field of combat sports, and they were willing to give up their time and expertise to, you know, help us. Because really, it was something to scratch our own itch, wasn't it? We was like, yeah. we want more information about the science behind. Sports science behind combat sports, and you know, there's not a lot of information out there, and so we just decided, right, we're going to do this, we're going to put it on because we want to learn more anyway. And I think just feeling a little bit humbled by, you know, the people that were willing to give their and to provide their expertise and knowledge was something that I found was, you know, was really great on their part.
So rolling on to May 2017, massive for Sheffield Boxing, as Kell Brook faced Errol Spence at Bramall Lane, and we had two fighters on the undercard, and one being Kyle Youssef, who we've worked with for a while. Always tell everybody how freakishly strong he is for his weight, really good athlete, and he came up with the goods against Louis Norman.
Absolutely. Louis Norman been in there with a few good lads, hasn't he? And you know, taking him a long way. So, you know, Kyle put on a you know, a great show against him, and you know, put him down as well, didn't he? I think so.
Yeah, put him down in the fifth or sixth round.
Yeah, which I don't think he'd been down before, did he?
No.
So, but Kyle, I love watching Kyle. I think he's a great athlete. I love, you know, watching him move and run. It's so explosive as well for his weight.
Unbelievable.
You know, he's a genuinely nice kid as well.
Yeah. So it's a laugh when it's about.
Yeah. So yeah, great performance for him. And then it was Anthony Fowler's debut as well, wasn't it?
Yeah. So Anthony Fowler, the power of social media slid into my direct messages on Instagram. And started training with us at Boxing Science, and it was really exciting because it's not often that you get somebody coming into the program that's got a strong body of strength conditioning behind them. They always start off on like doing movement and building strength foundations, but straight away we were able to get stuck into him and make him fitter, faster and stronger.
Yeah, he's got a real extensive history, training history, which meant that we could drop him in. Usually guys come in and they you know, they're not as strong as we would like, are they? Yeah. They don't move that well.
No.
Although they might be quite fit. They look a bit like an endurance athlete.
Yeah.
But you know, Anthony had that great base, and when we tested him, he really was a machine.
Yeah.
He really probably could have gone along at pegs all day long, you know, and not stop like a machine, just churning it out. Yeah. But you know, from that base, we made some really good improvements, haven't we? And we've seen some really positive changes from May time onwards.
So into the summer months now, in June, our boxers entered the Haringey Box Cup, a really famous tournament in amateur boxing. Brendan had a busy weekend with three lads entering the tournament over 3 days. It was boiling hot, supposedly. I weren't there. It was really long days because there's hundreds and hundreds of boxers that enter. But time weren't wasted as Will Simpson came away with a gold medal. And Will is the king of the curve. I don't think you would quite agree.
Joint king.
Quite agree with that. But he is literally the running man, isn't
he? Yeah. He loves digging in, don't he, on the curve.
Yeah.
He's got a great physique for the curve, hasn't he?
Yeah.
He's tall and heavy and forceful. His tech isn't bad.
Yeah. So also in June, we started our relationship with England Boxing, doing some testing sessions with the youth and junior boys and girls squad.
Yeah.
It was great to have them in. Basically, we took them through a testing protocol to show them the strengths and areas for improvement. And this is part of a big picture with doing some strength conditioning, doing some camp-based stuff, some remote stuff with their boxers as well, and also doing some education with their coaches. So it's a massive thing for not only Boxing Science, but for England Boxing too.
Yeah, it's huge. I mean, when the guys came in, I was really impressed with them. You know, they might have been young, but you know, they acted like professionals. They were all switched on, did exactly as you know they were told at when time, and they all pushed themselves as well, especially on that treadmill run that we've got. But I was really impressed with them, and you know, I think hopefully with our support, you know, and their continued development as well, and the development of the coaches too, then you know, the future is definitely bright for England Boxing.
Definitely. So between June and July, a little bit quieter because I went away for a month, which was great.
Yeah. I'm writing a thesis.
You were writing a thesis. So on the Boxing Science front, it was a little bit quieter, but whilst I was away, I was quite humbled with me kind of putting where I was location-wise, and I got invited to two different gyms out there. I got invited to a gym in Split in Croatia. Another one was in Slovenia by Andras Chua, I think I got that right. And he invited me to his gym in Ljubljana, I think I got that right.
What's the name of the gym? You can definitely get this right.
Golden Gloves Gym. And I went down and visited him. And when I put that up on like Facebook and on Instagram as well, that I'd been to their gym, I got invited to Nigeria, to Portugal, to Holland, if I'm ever passing through there, to visit their gym, and which showed to me like...
And America.
And America as well, yeah. Which kind of showed to me like how big Boxing Science has got in 2017 with the release of our programs and everything like that, how it's been accessed in different countries. And after that, I was like thinking, how many countries have we actually sold Train Like a Champion in? And it turns out to be 20 different countries.
Amazing, really. Power of the internet.
Yeah.
And social media, and yeah. But thank you to everyone, you know, who supported us so far. And, you know, thank you to Andras as well and everyone else who's invited Danny and myself over to their gyms. You know, it's really, really humbling. And you know, we never really expected it, or do expect it. So when it happens, we're just thanks. Yeah.
And following coming back from holiday, it was straight at it over to London to Wembley Arena, and Kid Galahad was in his biggest fight in the last few years against Jose Catiano.
Yeah,
I think got that right. and it was a dominant win.
Yeah.
It was great to see Barry back, like kind of boxing at that level. We know that he can do. He obviously got a lot of comparisons because he was facing a former foe of his foe, Scott Quigg.
Yeah.
And you know, he totally dominated him.
Yeah. He said before he was looking to blast him out before Quigg blasted him out.
Yeah.
But you know, he does. That's not the aim of the game, is it? The aim of the game is to work on your strengths and, you know, and take down your opponent, you know, and pick them off within your own game plan. And I think it was the same round he stopped him, wasn't it, I think?
Yeah.
But, you know, it was a great performance by Barry. He's always methodical, you know, he always picks his shots well, doesn't he? He always, you know, he throws
everything down systematically.
Systematically, yeah. He's very intelligent in the way that he fights. Yeah.
And that put him in a great position in the IBF rankings, number 5, yeah. behind Josh Warrington,
yeah.
Carl Frampton. I don't know where Quigg is. I think he's like around there. Yeah. And then Lee Selby at the top of the tree, which makes it quite interesting for 2018, because they're all wanting to face each other, and hopefully Barry gets his chance. Like I said, quite June and July, but in August, a bit of shock to the system as we was busier than ever. We had the restart of our training clusters. We had people coming back in to train one-to-one. Our youth training summer workshop and the launch of Boxing Science TV. Yeah. A great format to get our message across.
Yeah, absolutely love it. What yeah. episode we're in now, 12, something like that.
This is episode 11. 12.
Episode 12.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's great, isn't it?
Yeah.
Like, it's just, you know, stick a video camera in front and just, you know, chat for a little bit about, you know, about boxing and science and
boxing
TV.
Science. what we just mentioned there was our youth training workshop. We had one day with around about 10 young amateur boxers from Sheffield City ABC, and we educated them on like the importance and the different methods that we use in strength and conditioning and in nutrition and motivation as well. And it's really important for us to educate these young athletes and give them the ownership as well, because we don't see them that often in a week because they're in the boxing gym or they're at school or, you know, they're having to do the homework or something like that. With our boxers, they come in the morning, 7 o'clock in the morning, whereas youth and junior athletes, they might only be able to commit to one session as well. And with this in mind, we wanted to give them as much ownership of the programme as stuff that they can start doing at home and in the park or at the gym as well, making sure that they're preparing right for boxing. And this kind of philosophy that we have has been put into the youth training handbook, where we've got like a three-phase program where we're integrating the boxing science methods into the boxing training. And I think that this can be really big for boxing, as I say in the advert that we've done. It can be the cornerstone for athletic development for boxing's future champions.
Absolutely, yeah. Really, really excited for the youth training program, because like Dan said, it's, you know, if your young athletes are on this foundational development program, then that's going to lead them on in the next few years on to train like a champion. And we see this as really important part of boxing science. You know, it's actually fundamental. It has taken us a bit of a while to get around to doing it, but we're very proud and we're very pleased and privileged that we're now in the position to be able to get it out to you guys and for you to start on the program and to get your young boxers on the program as well. I think from our perspective, it's easier for us to train adults in the environment that we've got, and it's easier for us to transfer that information across.
Yeah.
So I think naturally it just took us a little bit of a while to get to know more the youth side of boxing and the specifics and the constraints, you know, and what kind of equipment that they have, what kind of environment they have, what demands are on the coaches, and, you know, all these things that just integrate into a successful program, and trying to understand how we can fit around that and how we can put our knowledge and expertise into a system that young athletes can get the most out of. And for us being in a more of a university environment, it's not a natural progression for us to do that. So I'm really pleased that we've taken the time and, you know, we've immersed ourselves in that environment before we start to bring anything out, because we could have just thrown out something, you know, suitable for an adult, you know, yeah. but they're not mini adults, are they? The kids, no. you know, and,
yeah.
and the constraints that they have as well, like you just mentioned, yeah. and the constraints that coaches have and the constraints that boxing gyms have, not the same at yeah. all. So this is very, very specific to the youth population in boxing, and it's not for football, it's not for rugby, it's not for track and field, is no. it? This is boxing specific.
Boxing Science are pioneering world-class training methods to get athletes fitter, faster and stronger. And our Train Like Champion programme has been accessed in 20 different locations worldwide. Now, we switch our attention to the next generation with our Train Like Champion Youth Athlete Edition. Boxing Science have developed a unique system for you to deliver athletic development programmes to your aspiring young athletes. We explain the science behind youth training and provide a guide on strength, movement and fitness training methods. This includes a three-phase programme that can be printed off as posters to put up in your gym and set a positive training environment. Each phase will include a physical warm-up that consists of the key movement patterns, a strength and core training program to help improve strength, speed and stability, and also a fantastic conditioning program that includes bodyweight circuits and shuttle runs. We have a recorded presentation from nutritionist Lee Rickards, educating young athletes about the basics of nutrition in combat sports. This is the world's first ever youth sports science program in boxing and can be the cornerstone to athletic development for the next generation of boxing champions. This unbelievable package will cover your training for the entire season and will help your young athletes fulfill their potential.
In September, we had another great month. We had Anthony Fowler at the end of the month performing in Liverpool, a great performance against Jay Byrne, who hadn't been stopped before. And it was great to have like a full 10-week camp with Anthony, because before it was just like little snippets, like boxing May, boxing June. We were like 4 or 5 weeks in between them fights, whereas we had 10 solid weeks training camp, and the numbers were really impressive. We also started working with Jamie and Gary McDonnell, the infamous Arkid twins. They're absolutely great to work with, and you know, if there's anybody that, you know, has that grit whilst running, it's them two, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. Mm. I mean, we push everyone to the absolute limits when they come in and they test, but you get to see the real champions when they're pushed to their absolute limits. You know, one of the things that we do with the treadmill max test is we ask people to go until they can literally not run anymore, and it's the reason why they wear a harness, because, you know, we have guys that are falling off the back of the treadmill. And that's the place that champions go to, because they've
back
got
of the treadmill.
Back of the treadmill, off the treadmill. Yeah. But that's the place that they go to, isn't it? They go
to justification for pushing it. And you got accused of being a crazy scientist by Fowler.
Yeah, because we want to, you know, if one stage ends, you've got 15 seconds recovery. You know, there's going to be a little bit recovery in there, you know, and I want to see exactly what our athletes have got physically, but also mentally as well. And all I want them to do when they think they've finished is to get on and try and do a little bit more. Try and do a little bit more, and it's the same in anything in life. You know, if you're always trying to do just that little bit more and take a few more steps, you know, work a little bit harder, do a little bit of more, a little more writing, a little more reading, a little more housework. Yeah. You know, it's going to be beneficial.
Yeah.
It's going to be beneficial for you in the long run. They bags and bags of grit.
Yeah.
And determination, those two.
Yeah, and they've got some fantastic results from the programme as well. But the main highlight of September was the return of the thrill, 18 months out, and he put on a great performance against somebody that was supposed to be durable and a bit of a test. A lot of people were thinking, oh, it's tough bout for him coming back off such a long period of inactivity, and he couldn't ask for anything better.
No, absolutely not. I mean, but he's not, he has been inactive competitively, hasn't he? But he's been sparring people like, you know, Ryan Burnett, hasn't he?
Yeah.
And, you know, he's been, obviously, when he was with the Ingalls, he was sparring those guys.
Yeah.
you know, he's been... He's
Lee
been,
Selby as well.
He's been sparring with Lee Selby, and, you know, he's... the guys, when he's, you know, moves to Caldwell, you know, Caldwell's gym, he's sparring with those guys as well. And to be honest, the guys that he's competing against now, they're nowhere near the kind of level of guys that he's training
and
sparring with, are they? So, you know, although he's been relatively inactive and people might think, oh, I might have a little bit of ring rust, what you saw was just a guy that's just been preparing like the ultimate champion, like eventually will be.
Yeah. Imagine if he had that training camp mentality.
Yeah.
And he only came in for 10 weeks. Well, he only had, 4 weeks three, 4 weeks notice for that fight. So very pleasing to see him back in and follow that up with another win as well, another impressive performance. Yeah. And hopefully he's going to go on to a very big 2018.
Looking forward to that.
In October, we had Ray Ginley, a boxing coach from Belfast, with one of his boxers, Lewis Crocker, a great prospect for Belfast boxing and welterweight. And he started a remote sports science programme with us. So he came over, did some sports science testing, set up the programme, talked to him about monitoring and everything like that. And even though it was a long distance between Sheffield and Belfast, it's a flight and it takes about... People say, oh, it's only a 45-minute flight, but I went the other week and it took me about 4 or 5 hours overall travel to get here. But people don't realise that our services are accessible by anyone, wherever you are, in the UK, across Europe. People, if they want to travel from America, they can do if they want. Wherever. So we set up the programme for them, set Ray... to set up Lewis to do his training with Ray, and worked out to be successful as well.
Absolutely, yeah. You know, his big prospect is the Croc.
Yeah.
And Ray is a top guy. He's a young coach, but everything that I see of Ray, he's always studying boxing.
Yeah.
He's studying all the time, isn't he?
Yeah.
And you know, I think he will definitely be a great coach. He'll have some really good boxers in the future. You know, he's forward thinking as well, isn't he? Really forward thinking. He's willing to learn and to take on as much information as he can and absorb it.
Yeah. And talking about like coaches that are forward thinking as well, we had a group of them join us in our first ever coaching workshops, our Ultimate Coaching for Combat Sports. Kickstarted that in London, Feltham, back end of October, and that's probably one of the highlights for a project side for me in 2017.
Yeah, definitely. I think what the workshop demonstrated was that there is, you know, a group of very passionate and enthusiastic coaches who are hungry and thirsty for knowledge to help improve their boxers and combat athletes. And you know, the group of people that we got on the course, on the first ever course that we got, couldn't have asked for a better group, really, could we? Because they were, you know, attentive, they got involved in absolutely everything, they were asking the right questions, you know, and they were, you know, we were as much appreciative of them as they were of us. So it was, you know, really, 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 you know, mutually beneficial experience, I thought, you know. And you know, how many at the end, you know with the guys, like, with, you know, not just shaking each other's hand and say right, all the best, they were actually, you know, like high-fiving and, you know, man hugs and you know, all that kind of stuff. So you know, you don't often see that, and you don't usually get that feel. But I think as well, coming from that combat background, you know, they do tend to end up bond out and you're getting quite close anyway because of the sport.
Yeah, and I'm a massive fan of Oasis, if you don't know already, but in the Supersonic film, they say it's not all about the songs, it's about the people that sing it back to you. And that's what I felt like when leaving that, like thinking all these, like, we've done all this work and we don't really see the people that can buy our products and engage with our products online. for us to put something out there and people be really interested in what we're doing, because we do it to the boxers and we could be giving them anything and they're just like, yeah, 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 they'll just do whatever. We try and explain them the science, they're just like, whatever. So to actually go through, right, this is what we do, this is how we've researched it, this is research that backs it up and the evidence, and these are the results that we're getting as well. And for people to take note and be impressed and engaged with it and everything like that, it were a great feeling. And I think I had a 6-hour drive back.
Oh, yeah,
but I was like out driving, like no, absolutely that was a buzzing. Goal. Yeah. And after that, following into November, quick turnaround for me and for Alan and Mayo as well, as I went out to Monaco to support Jim McDonnell in his world title defences rematch with Solis. And it was great to go out there and help do his weight making and making sure that it was done optimally, rather than there's so many times where we've kind of give the protocol out and we're not able to go or anything like that, and then you're worrying on the phone because you're not in control. I've never been so cool as somebody making weight in the life, really. Yeah. Going out there and doing it.
Yeah. I mean, it just comes down to having that, you know, knowledge and expertise and having the structure and monitoring and quantifying as many things as possible and making sure it's, you know, every base is covered, you know, from nutrition to hydration and, you know, to being aware of what Jamie wants and what he doesn't want and what he needs and what he doesn't need, you know, and taking the various aspects of science and, you know, applying that in a very specific context as well. You know, I mean, you see so many times that the way that people actually make the weight, you know, is completely wrong. Yeah. It's completely the wrong way of doing it. You know, and Jamie said it was the best he'd ever felt in the way of making weight, and you know, people were saying how good he looked, and you know, and he was ready to put on a big performance, wasn't he? And he was, you know, he was coming into the fight in that third round, wasn't he?
Unfortunately, he got cut just above the eye, and it was a bad cut. It was exciting when he got cut, actually, because he just went toe-to-toe for him. He was buzzing off it. But it was great, like, you know, like I say, for me to have that experience of going out and helping Jamie do that weight cut safe. But also, on the other end of the phone was two doctors, Alan Ruddock and Mehran Chordas, one expert in nutrition and one in heat acclimation, to go into a hotter country, somebody that needs to lose water, to have two people kind of on the other end of the phone helping us. I was just like, right, well, there were little things happening and, you know, a great support team, really.
Yeah. It was a good job, wasn't it? It was a good job because, you know, when you prepare well and you can monitor things and you've got an athlete that's got himself already in good shape and has done everything right. Yeah. You know, he ticked every box leading up to it, didn't he?
Yeah.
You know, it's makes your job a lot easier and you can be a lot more confident because there's always that uncertainty, isn't there? You know, it's going to push him over the edge. You know, are you going to, you know, cause a bit of damage, or are you going to you know, put someone in a situation that, you know, it could be fairly dangerous.
Yeah. And testing the hydration before and after made me feel more satisfied.
Well, he was always hydrated throughout the whole thing, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Throughout the whole thing, there was not one point where we had a osmolality, which is a measure of hydration, where he was dehydrated.
Yeah.
You know, you get football players coming in on the morning of a training session that are less hydrated than Jamie was making weight.
Yeah.
And that's how well he did it.
Yeah, for sure. Okay, into the final month, December, and I repaid the favour and going visiting Ray Ginley and Lewis Crockham whilst I was out there. Did a seminar, Science Behind Boxing, and it was a great response because we only released the details of the seminar in 6 days in advance, and we had 18 coaches turn up, and it seems like there's a passion for boxing out there, but passion for sports science in boxing as well.
Yeah.
Fantastic. And big thing in December as well was Billy Joe Saunders putting on a masterclass against David Lemieux, defending his WBO middleweight title. He came in for testing and doing some altitude training sessions with you as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And he's been doing, you know, the conditioning sessions over at the Ingle Gym with Dom that you know, that we've done with the guys before. So, you know, it was conditioning, doing the conditioning work and the runs on the program that we'd set before. Done some work with us in the altitude tent as well, you know, a bit of testing as well. So really looking forward to a big 2018 and, you know, continuing that relationship with Billy Joe.
And with Billy Joe, like, even though, like, you know, we only had a few sessions with him, Dom puts in, like you say, the conditioning methods, the evidence-based training methods, and the right nutrition as well. And Billy Joe was like kind of the poster boy for like kind of boxing skill. So you see like the different memes where it's like body shapes don't matter. And it was like him versus Eubank all ripped up, and him not looking as ripped up as Eubank. And he was like kind of the post boy for like not doing strength and conditioning and everything like that. And then it goes to Dom. He starts putting in the conditioning methods and the evidence-based methods, and he's improved massively, and he's showing that fitness has helped him actually unlock his potential, and that's exactly what we want him to do.
Yeah.
And when I was going out to Belfast and doing the seminar, I put a slide up, and I'll put this slide up now, where the sum of kind of training, the sum of testing results from strength, movement, punch force, and conditioning as well. The strength and conditioning methods that we do has helped improve, on average, overall results of 15% extra. And when I was like presenting this, I was like, which one would you rather be, or your boxer rather be? You know, the one that's down here, or the one that's up here at 15%
absolutely
better.
Yeah. I mean, you take 1%, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
You take 1 or 2%.
Yeah.
You know, every time, if you could have an extra 1 or 2%, in the ring, in your performance, you take it every time. So, you know, for 15%, and we're not fudging the numbers here.
No.
Let's be honest, we're not making anything up. I suppose if you really want to see the data set, you can see the data set. You know, but 15% is huge.
Massive.
But it comes down to, you know, consistency and application on the boxer side as well. You can write the best program in the world, can't you? But if you can't coach it like you coach it, and you don't have a relationship with the boxers like that you've got with them, then you're not going to get those results.
Yeah. And a really good thing that you said in that Box Nation feature was the that cycling looking for 1% and Formula One are looking for 0.1% and we're still looking for the 5% and the 10%. Actually, we're getting 15%, which is absolutely massive.
So
thanks for watching our 2017 review. We hope you've enjoyed it, as you know, I've enjoyed like kind of looking through. The year can just kind of pass you by sometimes, and when I've actually gone through like Instagram and social media feeds and everything like that and gone, oh, but man, I forgot about that, and put it down on paper and then go through it in a video, you realize how much we've actually achieved.
Yeah, it can all merge into one or be forgotten, you know, things. You know, when I was going through the list with you of what we've done, like,
yeah.
Remember that now.
We've actually missed that so much as well.
Yeah, we probably have. Just go scroll through Danny's Insta.
Yeah. All right, so thanks for watching. And just a little bit of a reminder of our Kickstart Your 2018 program, where we've got strength conditioning, high-intensity interval training, movement training, core training, conditioning circuits, recipe handbook to make sure that you've got some nice meals to have in January, immunity guide so you're basically staying healthy and not having setbacks when you're working towards your goals, and making them goals as well, so we help you make your New Year's resolution. And I hope everyone has a good Christmas. Over the Christmas period, we are going to be posting different videos, different highlights on our Instagram and our YouTube pages. But for now, have a good Christmas and Happy New Year.
Merry Christmas, Happy New Year. Thanks for all your support as well.
Yeah, cheers.